Will that green tea or acai juice make you live longer and be a lot healthier? The term antioxidant has become a marketing term synonymous with healthful, but does the hype really hold up to reality? Before we discuss antioxidants, we need to go back and look at a little biochemistry to put this all into context. First, I want to describe for you what a free radical is, or we could just call it a radical. Radicals are molecules that are highly reactive. Now, to review some really basic chemistry, apologize if this is too basic, but just so we're all starting at the same point, atoms have positively charged protons along with uncharged neutrons. The number of protons in an atom determines what element it is. Those are both in the nucleus. And around them are electrons, negatively charged electrons. Generally speaking, there will be one electron for each proton in an atom. Ions are atoms that have fewer or more electrons than protons, so they carry a net electrical charge. Electrons aren't just whizzing around their nuclei in some chaotic or random fashion. They're very highly organized and structured. They fill what we call electron shells. First, the innermost shells, when the inner shell is full, then electrons will go to the next shell. When that gets filled, then they start filling up the shell after that, filling one after the other in a sequence. Now, atoms are in their most stable state, which means their lowest energy state, when their outermost shell is full of electrons. In addition to liking to fill their outer shell, atoms also like to have all of their electrons paired. Again, this puts them into the lowest energy state. Specifically, with paired electrons, by spinning in opposite directions, paired electrons balance each other out. Now, a free radical is essentially any atom or molecule that has an unpaired electron in its outermost shell. Atoms with unpaired electrons like to form bonds with other atoms or molecules. The way atoms do this, the way they bind together, is by sharing electrons. They form an electron bond. So two atoms that are each missing electrons from their outermost shell can share an electron and fill their outermost shells, and that forms a lower energy or more stable state. In essence, that forms a bond between those two atoms, and that's one of the bases of molecules, of basic chemistry. Now, how does this apply to the human body or actually any living organism? Animals have organelles in every living cell called mitochondria. These mitochondria are actually like little bacteria. They probably were at one point in the distant evolutionary past of all animals an actual separate organism that formed a symbiotic relationship with the eukaryotic cells that went on to form multicellular life. Now there are what we call organelles, many of them in every living cell, and they are the energy factories. Mitochondria use oxygen to burn fuel and create energy in the form of ATP or adenosine triphosphate. ATP are the little batteries of our cells. That third phosphate bond is very high energy, and then they contribute that energy to other reactions, like contracting your muscles and doing all the things that cells do, by breaking that phosphate bond and going back down to ADP or adenosine diphosphate. So again, that chemical bond is where the energy for our cells comes from. Now, in the process of making ATP from essentially the macronutrients in food, mitochondria generate a lot of oxygen, what we call oxygen-free radicals, a byproduct of oxygen energy production. Now, these free radicals are oxygen molecules that are also free radicals in that they have an unpaired electron in their outer shell. Some of these specific reactive oxygen species, as we also call them, include superoxide, hydrogen peroxide, and hydroxyl radical. Some of you may have hydrogen peroxide, in your drug cabinet. You may notice when you pour it onto, say, a fresh cut, it fizzes. That's because, again, it's very, very highly reactive. It'll kill bacteria and viruses because it is an oxygen-free radical. These reactive oxygen species can cause damage. They can cause damage to the cell. They can cause damage to DNA. They are particularly reactive to lipids, which form the membranes of all living cells. They do this by reacting very aggressively with other molecules. Now, that may sound very scary that we have oxygen-free radicals inside of our body going around destroying our cells and DNA, but actually they exist in an equilibrium and they actually also serve some beneficial effects inside our bodies. For example, they are used by some cells of the immune system to attack and destroy bacteria and viruses. Oxygen-free radicals are also used as chemical signals that trigger important functions inside the cell. So you wouldn't want to completely get rid of them. They actually do serve a function in the body. Finally, this is where antioxidants come in. Now, because these oxygen-free radicals are an unavoidable byproduct of energy production in the mitochondria and all of our cells, that it stands to reason we would have evolved, you know, animals in general, mechanisms to sop up those oxidative free radicals and to keep them from doing damage. Substances which do that are called antioxidants. Essentially, when you have a free radical, like an oxygen free radical, it causes a chain reaction. It steals an electron from another molecule to fill its outer shell, turning that molecule into a free radical. That molecule then steals an electron from a different molecule in order to fill its outer shell, but turning the next molecule into a free radical. And you have what is potentially an endless chain of stealing electrons from molecules, and this can potentially be disruptive and can break down DNA and membranes and other components of the cell. What an antioxidant does is that that's any molecule that can donate a free electron to a free radical without itself becoming a free radical. So it ends the chain. It ends this chain reaction of oxidative damage. There are a number of naturally occurring antioxidants in the body. The two most common are vitamin E and vitamin C. They're the most abundant that we use. There are also many specific enzymes, specifically superoxide dismutase and others such as glutathione. And they are there partly to reduce these oxygen-free radicals, to end these chain reactions, and to keep the whole system in equilibrium. So, we've described some of the basic science. Now we know what free radicals are. We know why we have oxygen-free radicals in our body. We know what antioxidants are and why they are a critical biochemical component of the normal biochemistry of our bodies. But what about taking antioxidants themselves? What about eating antioxidants or taking supplements? Well, beginning in the 1990s, the possibility that cellular damage from oxidative stress was actually the underlying cause of not only normal aging, but many neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or Lou Gehrig's disease, was proposed as a serious scientific notion. And in fact, this was cutting edge, very interesting science, perfectly legitimate. And many of us were very excited by the prospect that antioxidants in some dose would become very effective in slowing down the progression of these diseases, maybe even halting the progression of these diseases. We all anticipated greatly the clinical trials that would show that antioxidants were effective. This turns out to be a very interesting and very illuminating story of how science develops and how sometimes our initial, somewhat naive and simplistic notions don't pan out. The story of antioxidants didn't turn out the way any of us thought or hoped it would. So, what did that research show? Like I've discussed previously, there are different kinds of scientific research, and once we had sorted out some of the basic science about oxidative stress and antioxidants, we moved on to animal studies. And animal studies were encouraging. They showed that oxidative stress is playing a role in cell damage and death. When a cell dies, we call that apoptosis, and oxidative damage or free radical damage was playing a role in apoptosis or cell death. It also turns out that as we get older, we lose some of our naturally occurring antioxidant capacity, so it makes sense that replenishing them would be beneficial. And the brain, where those many of those diseases that I talked about, those neurodegenerative diseases where the damage is taking place, is particularly susceptible to oxidative stress because the brain consumes a lot of oxygen. It therefore produces a correspondingly increased amount of oxygen-free radicals. And lipids are especially responsive to oxidative damage, and there's a lot of lipids in the structure of the brain. So a lot of the pieces were fitting together, and again, we were all very excited about the prospects here. However, the stories are always more complicated than we at first assume. And it's possible, and this was also raised as a cautionary concern, that the oxidative stress leading to cell damage, leading to apoptosis, may have been a secondary effect, not the primary underlying cause of cell death in these neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's disease. In other words, it's just one of the many things that happens when cells are dying, but it wasn't the original or underlying cause of those cells dying. So let's go to some specific diseases that I mentioned. For example, Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is a neurodegenerative disorder where people may have a tremor, they have difficulty walking and moving, they become very stiff. The part of the brain that enables us to move smoothly and fluidly is what's being damaged. Specifically, neurons in the substantia nigra that produce a neurotransmitter called dopamine start to slowly die off. And as they die off, the disease gets more and more severe until, in the end stage of the disease, the dopaminergic or dopamine-producing neurons in the substantia nigra are completely gone, and patients have a very severe manifestation of the disease. Well, in animal models of Parkinson's disease, antioxidants showed that they were beneficial. It slowed down the progression of the disease. As a side note, I do have to mention that animal models of human diseases, while sometimes very good, are never perfect, and we could never be sure that what's happening in a rat with Parkinson's disease is identical to what's happening in a human who develops sporadic Parkinson's disease. Oftentimes, animal models are genetic. We find a mutation that mimics the disease, but in humans, it's not genetic, it's sporadic. It occurs without any specific genetic disorder. So the animal models are not perfect, but when animal models do work, it's an important proof of concept, and once again, we were on track. Antioxidants were looking very favorable. However, when we finally got to those definitive human trials, the only point at which we really know if something is going to work or not, antioxidants had no detectable beneficial effect in either preventing the development of Parkinson's disease or in slowing its progression. Unfortunately, it just didn't work. It was actually quite a disappointment. The story is very similar for Alzheimer's disease, a disease that causes progressive dementia or difficulty with memory and concentration and cognition. Animal models again suggested that there might be benefit from vitamin C and vitamin E, again, the two most abundant antioxidants in the body. However, human trials showed mixed results at best. Some were positive, some were negative. There wasn't any compelling evidence for benefit, even at high doses. So again, we're left with maybe there's a tiny benefit that we can't really detect statistically, but there certainly is no big effect from antioxidants with Alzheimer's disease. And a third example, ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease, a disease that I treat myself quite often as a neurologist. Now, animal models of ALS, again, this is a very interesting story that we have developed an animal model for ALS. It's mice who have a mutation called a SOD1 mutation, a mutation in the gene for superoxide dismutase, which, remember, is one of the enzymes that's a naturally occurring antioxidant. That was very promising. So now we have a mutation in a gene for a naturally occurring antioxidant being associated with, in fact, causing a neurodegenerative disorder, ALS, in these SOD1 mice. That was huge support for the antioxidant or the oxidative stress hypothesis of ALS. But again, biology always turns out to be more interesting and more complex than we initially think. And it turns out that the mutated SOD1 protein not only was it not doing its job as an antioxidant, it was also directly toxic to motor neurons, the neurons that are dying in ALS. So now we couldn't really separate out how much was this mutation killing off motor neurons because it's directly toxic, and how much was it killing off neurons because it wasn't doing its job as an antioxidant. So we were left with just studying antioxidants in people with ALS to see if they work. And the results, again, were disappointing. Studies of vitamin E and vitamin C, especially in high doses, did not affect the outcome of the disease, did not slow the progression of the disease, and vitamin E was studied to see if it prevented the disease from occurring in the first place, and again, it was completely negative. So, the scientific community was very humbled by this experience. We had every reason to think that antioxidants were going to be a huge cure for many serious illnesses, with potential even going beyond that. And yet, 15, 20 years of clinical research completely disappointed us. What about cancer prevention? That's another entity in which we think, all right, oxidative stress may damage DNA. DNA mutations lead to cancer, a very plausible mechanism. And in fact, there is evidence that eating several servings per day of fruits and vegetables is associated with up to a 30% decrease in overall cancer risk and greater longevity. Fruits and vegetables contain antioxidants. Eating them protects against cancer and improves longevity. However, we can't necessarily conclude that it's the antioxidants that are doing this. The exact mechanism of this clear benefit from fruits and vegetables has yet to be determined. High antioxidants may be playing a role, but there's other variables as well. Perhaps there are other things in fruits and vegetables that are healthful. Perhaps people who eat fruits and vegetables engage in other activities which are healthful or avoid activities which have a higher risk of cancer. Perhaps if you eat lots of fruits and vegetables, you're not eating as much of other kinds of foods that may not be helpful, that may increase your risk of cancer. There's simply too many variables to know if it's the antioxidants or what exact role the antioxidants are playing in cancer prevention. But one clue we have is antioxidant supplements. If it is the antioxidants in the fruits and vegetables, then taking a pill with antioxidants in it should have the same benefit. However, the research shows overall that taking antioxidant supplements, as opposed to eating fruits and vegetables with antioxidants, does not decrease cancer risk. So that would argue against antioxidants being the definitive factor. Beta-carotene, vitamin A, was associated with a higher risk of cancer in smokers, a paradoxical outcome. It probably still needs to be replicated in further studies, but the evidence we have so far shows that vitamin A may be counterproductive in smokers specifically who have lung cancer. Selenium was associated with a reduced risk of cancer risk in men, but not women. Why that difference can't be explained on the basis of antioxidant effects alone. What about heart health? Here the story is really interesting. Antioxidants do reduce cholesterol plaque buildup and therefore may reduce atherosclerosis and the risk of heart attacks. And again, eating fruits and vegetables is definitely associated with a lower risk of cardiac disease. But a recent meta-analysis, a meta-analysis is when you take multiple studies and you pool the data and analyze all the data together. So essentially, it's an attempt at turning a few small to moderate-sized trials into one large trial. It's not a perfect technique, but it is helpful to try to get a sense of what is the consensus of data in a large number of studies. This meta-analysis of studies of vitamin E and heart disease showed no benefit at any dose. This was especially true for secondary prevention, meaning preventing your second heart attack after you've already had the first one. Now, studies of beta-carotene actually showed an increase in cardiac disease and mortality. So here again, like with the vitamin A and smokers with lung cancer, we're seeing a paradoxical increased risk. Taking beta-carotene is therefore not recommended for those with heart disease or with significant risk factors for heart disease. So far from antioxidant vitamins being a panacea or even being very, very useful for health, they either don't work or in some cases they even increase risk. What about longevity? Of course, we all want to live longer. We all want to live as long as we can. In addition to causing cellular damage, oxidative stress contributes to DNA damage, which is considered a very important part of aging. And in addition to the evidence I've already mentioned, healthy centenarians, people who lived over 100, tend to have higher levels of vitamin A and E than other people who are older but not quite as old. So that's some observational data that suggests that having higher amounts of antioxidants in your body is correlating with living longer. Great, who doesn't want to live past 100? But other kinds of observational studies are mixed. So we're not seeing a clear example here. What we really need are good experimental studies. However, those are really hard to do. If you imagine how long would a trial need to be to see if you can live 5 or 10 or 20 years longer from taking antioxidants for the majority of your life? Well, those studies would have to be 30, 40 years long. They're incredibly impractical. And you would have to monitor compliance with taking supplements or placebos, for example, throughout that whole period of time. So for purely practical reasons, we don't have really good, very long-term experimental studies. We have short-term experimental studies, and we have some medium to long-term observational studies, and there the results are basically mixed, and therefore there's certainly no huge effect, but we can't rule out that there may be a small beneficial effect. But certainly we would argue against taking high doses because of the potential increased heart risk. So what are the broad lessons from the antioxidant story? I think it's a really fascinating story, and I actually lived through it in my career. I graduated medical school in 1991, right at the beginning of the antioxidant craze, and here we are 19 years later, and the story did not turn out the way I thought it was going to, and the way the scientific community thought it was going to. But interestingly, the public perception that antioxidants are healthful and are a net good for health has persisted despite the fact that the scientific evidence just did not turn out that way. So let me pull back and explain what I think are some of the really broad lessons for understanding medical science and avoiding the trap of medical myths. One is that we cannot easily rely on animal studies. While animal studies are critical in the process of designing human trials, our animal models of the diseases that we're studying are not perfect, and they do not always, in fact, they often don't, predict the outcome of later definitive human trials. Also, we cannot easily or simplistically extrapolate from the basic science research. Always beware when someone's trying to sell you a product and justifying clinical claims based upon interesting things that happen in test tubes and petri dishes. Basic science tells us what kind of directions we should go in with clinical research, but they can't be used to make clinical claims. More often than not, we're going to be wrong when we guess what the outcome should be based upon just our basic understanding of basic biochemistry and biology. And also, clinical data is often conflicting. There is, you know, very rarely a single definitive end be-all of all studies. There's different kinds of clinical data with different kinds of strengths and weaknesses, and you need to put it all together and see what the consistent consensus of those studies are. If you focus on one study or one slice of information, you could tell pretty much whatever story you want to. It won't necessarily, however, be the correct story. Also, another take-home message is that we shouldn't assume that vitamins are risk-free. Vitamins, like anything else, are an intervention. It's something we put into our bodies that will affect the biochemistry, and everything needs to be considered as risk versus benefit, and we should not assume a zero risk for vitamins just because there are things that our body needs naturally. Especially when we get to quote-unquote megadoses, where you're taking 10 to 100 times the dose that is the minimum necessary to avoid a deficiency, or that the kind of things you would find in most multivitamins, for example. I remember very distinctly in the late 90s and around the turn of the millennium, when the initial clinical data was not really turning out positive for antioxidants, and the proponents were telling me, that's because we're not studying it in a high enough dose. The reason why these results are negative is you need to push the dose up higher. But of course, that was just an assumption used to explain away the negative evidence. It turns out when you push the dose higher, you start to get into toxicity. You actually started to get into an increased risk of heart disease and cancer in some situations. Also, to some degree, we have to respect our own evolutionary history. Animals have had to deal with oxidative stress for literally hundreds of millions of years. That's powerful evolutionary selective pressure to sort of work out as optimal a way as biochemically possible to deal with this. And the story turned out to be much more complicated than we thought. You know, again, back in the early 90s, you might have thought that oxidative stress is bad, it causes damage, and antioxidants are good because it minimizes damage, and that was pretty much the end of the story. But it turns out that oxygen-free radicals and other free radicals in the body serve a useful purpose too. They also are signaling proteins. Essentially, the cell will detect the amount of free radicals that it has, and that will trigger other downstream protective effects, like producing what we call heat shock proteins, which protect the cell from damage. If you take large amounts of antioxidants from the outside, what we call exogenously, basically pills with antioxidants in them, then that disrupts the balance that naturally evolved between oxidative stress and antioxidants and all the other signaling and other things that are happening in response to that. And when you disrupt that equilibrium, we shouldn't assume that we can easily predict what the effects are going to be. And in fact, we need to be very cautious before we do things like that, take mega doses to disrupt what the evolved equilibrium that has been there. And we have been humbled. It turns out that taking large doses is not only not beneficial, it may in fact be harmful. So what's the bottom line of all this? There's no evidence to support the routine use of antioxidant supplements or so-called superfoods like acai juice or nani juice or even blueberry or pomegranate juice that are loaded with antioxidants. There's simply no benefit that taking pills or taking these specific superfoods has any health benefit. The evidence keeps leading us back to a few common bits of wisdom that most of us know to be true. What your mother said was in fact true. You should eat your fruits and vegetables, especially your vegetables, every day. And also another bottom line is do not take mega doses of vitamins. There is no evidence for benefit, and there is increasing evidence and increasing concern about possible toxicity and negative side effect to mega dosing. However, it should be noted that foods that are rich in antioxidants, like fruits and vegetables, have proven health benefits. They're also a lot cheaper than most expensive tropical fruit juices or expensive supplements that somebody may be trying to get you to buy. You probably cannot fix a poor diet with a pill. That's another take-home message. You can't sprinkle it on your steak. You have to eat a well-rounded diet with plenty of vegetables. So, to conclude this lecture, I would say, first of all, that there are things that we can do to extend our life. So the news is not all bad and not all negative. Here are some things that have been proven over and over again, and a recent review of the evidence shows that these things are all extremely important. Eating your fruits and vegetables every day, regular exercise, 20 to 30 minutes at least 3 days a week. Don't smoke. And avoid excessive drinking. Say no more than 2 drinks per day for men and one per day for women. If you do these 4 things, things that, let's face it, we all know we should do, then you can prolong your life on average by 12 years. You will be 12 years younger biologically than somebody who doesn't exercise, smokes, drinks, and doesn't eat their fruits and vegetables. So we have the knowledge and the means to live a longer, healthier life by focusing on those things that we clearly know have a huge effect on health. And we shouldn't get distracted by little things that may have a tiny effect, but the evidence really doesn't show anything definitive. This lecture concludes the first series of lectures in this course. Starting with the next lecture, we're going to start discussing specific diseases and treatments.